go ahead and sit down. I got this, Pastor Henry. Well, great to have all of you with us today. How's it going?
Good.
Going good. Great. All right. Well, if you're new with us, welcome to Calvary Beaumont. Great to have you. We are currently going through the book of Acts. Mark Twain said this. It said, "The two most important days in your life are the day you are born and the day you find out why." Why? Why am I here? Just maybe God has a purpose and a plan for you. Do you believe that?
Yes.
That's like half of you. 60-40. Hopefully we'll get to 90-10 later on down in the message. We're talking about purpose. This is the definition of purpose. The reason for which something is done or created or for which something exists. What I love about purpose is it's ageless. Purpose is ageless. So if you're in here this morning and you're a teenager, or you're in here this morning and you're a great-grandparent, purpose is still the same. God still has a purpose for you. Let me illustrate it like this. Most of you probably have something like this, right? You have an iPhone or some kind of device. Now, these devices were created to do many things. You can play Candy Crush. You know, you can post to Facebook. You can watch some movies. All of these things are great. But you know what this little symbol means. That means your phone is about to die. You're like, oh no, where's all of my chargers? So you go over to a friend's house or something for a meal, and all of a sudden, your phone is dying, so you ask them, hey, do you have a charger? The world's going to end because my phone is about to die, okay? So you're all concerned about your phone. So as great as your phone is, without power, it can do nothing. Your phone ever go to low power mode? You're like, man, that means I can't receive too many texts. The screen's going to go dim. So as much as you can do with this iPhone, without power, it's not going to have any purpose. It's not going to work. It's simply just going to be one of those things you're stressing out about. Okay, if no one has a charger, what's going to happen now? But once your phone is fully charged, Candy Crush is good. You can post again to Facebook. You can surf the net. You can watch some movies. You can send a text. Now, some of you are going, you can watch movies on your phone? What? Yes, you can. It all goes to this thing called purpose. Today in our text, we're going to talk a lot about purpose and trust. If you've been with us for a little while, Peter and John, filled with the Holy Spirit, they go to the temple. They see this guy that was born crippled. They raise him up in the name of Jesus. People come around asking, what's going on? They give the gospel, but then the religious people are going, hey, what's this name of Jesus you're teaching in? Hey, you're going to jail. So they spend the night in jail to think about what they're doing. Then they get out of jail, and they're before the religious, and the religious say, hey, tell us by what power you've done these things. They have a little conversation. They say, okay, don't preach anymore in this name of Jesus. So we pick up our story here in Acts chapter 4, and the title of our message is Power for What?
Your
Purpose. That means you can't go to sleep, because we're talking about you and your purpose. So we're in Acts chapter 4. We're going to start at verse 23. When you get there, give me an amen.
Amen.
Good job, everybody. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and the book of Acts. Starting at verse 23, it tells us this. It says, "And being let go, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. So when they heard that, they raised their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, you are God who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of your servant David has said, why do the nations rage and the people plot vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. Verse 27. For truly against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together to do whatever your hand and your purpose determined before to be done. Let's stop right there for just a couple of minutes if you are taking notes. Our first point this morning is trusting in God's purpose. I love the fact that when the disciples were released from the religious, they went to their friends, and their friends didn't say, I told you not to get involved with this whole Jesus guy. You know what? This is a sign from God. Don't do this anymore. The religious, their friends didn't say that. Their friends were in total agreement. It says, and they prayed. They began to be in agreement. How wonderful it is to have some friends that when you go to them, they'll tell you, let's pray. Anybody have any praying friends? You come before them like five or six, you have praying friends. Okay, we want to build that praying group later on. You go to your friends with a need, and they lift you up in prayer. What does the scripture say? It says they prayed, Lord, you are God who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them. The disciples could have said, you know what? We're living our lives right. We didn't do anything wrong. All of a sudden, we're in jail. All of a sudden, we're in front of these religious people. They went to their friends. The first thing they did is they prayed. They reminded themselves that, Lord, you are God. You made the earth, the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that's in them. They reminded themselves of who God is. When was the last time you were going through something and you reminded yourself who God is? That's what we forget sometimes. We're going through things, and all we see is this thing we're going through. The disciples said, you know what, Lord? You're God. You created the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that's in them. So if you are God, that means everything is in your control and in your power. We need to remind ourselves that God has a plan and a purpose. Now, that plan and purpose may include a little bit of pain. Amen. Thing called life. A little painful. But what if God wants to work in that pain? What if God wants to bring about his will in the pain? Sometimes we go through pain and we're thinking, God, where are you? Where are you? Where are you? He's in the pain with us. He's in the pain with us. He has a plan and a purpose. The disciples' lives were not like seashells and balloons. But Jesus was right there with them. And what they did is they didn't say, woe is me, woe is me. No, they reminded themselves, Lord, you are God. You are greater than anything that I will ever come against. And may I not forget. That's why it's good to keep this on our lips. Because sometimes life happens and we don't want to see anything. We just want to walk through life like this. I don't want to see it. I don't want to see it. I don't want to see it. But what if we say, God? Lord, you're God. Everything that happens, obviously, you're the creator of the universe. Just maybe you have a plan and a purpose for the things that are going on in my life. May God help us to trust his purpose for us. Now, I'm like you. Sometimes I'm like, God, I don't know what you're doing. I don't know what's... Obviously, you have a vantage point. Obviously, you know more than I, but I don't know what you are doing right now. I mean, God, do you see what's going on? God, do you feel this pain? God, do you know? His answer is obviously yes. God knows. God knows all things. He's above all. There's a big word called sovereign, that God is sovereign over all things. He's all-powerful. He's all-knowing. And what I love about the disciples is that they left that place rejoicing. They found themselves surrounded by other people who wanted to point them back to God. If you don't have anyone in your life that is able to point you to Jesus, you don't need them. No amen for that one, huh? They're like, that's a little too early for stuff like that, Pastor Man. If you don't have someone in your life to tell you, don't forget God. Don't forget God. Because sometimes you may have a friend or two that'll just jump right on your raining parade. Oh, things are so bad. You're like, yeah, things are so bad for you. You call somebody else, yeah, things are so bad for you. Let us be the type of friends that say, you know what, things are bad for you. But let me read you a scripture. Let me tell you who we serve. Let me tell you who loves you. So let's not hook on our cabooses to sorrow. Let's detach some of those cabooses and say, here's some joy. You're going through a tough time right now. But when God says that your time is done, oh, it's going to be worth it all. The disciples were around people who pointed them back to God. Listen to what James says. He says, my brethren, count it all what? Joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Remember when you made that mistake of praying for patience? We were being really spiritual. You know what, God? Give me some patience. He's like, oh, yeah, I've got an abundance of that for you. How did that week work out for you? Yeah. Patience is not something that, it'll change your life. But James says, count it all joy. Why? Because God has a plan and a purpose for our trials that we go through. God is shaping us and molding us. That's why James can say, hey, you count this all joy. Now, I want to confess to you, I'm not there yet. I want to be there, but I've never said, yes, my life hurts, and thank you, Jesus. I want to be there to where I just want to count it all joy. I just want to remind myself, God, I know you're doing something. God, I know you're doing something. And then I want to surround myself with people that can say, hey, Pastor Man, God is doing something. God, could you imagine if you had someone in your life that you can turn to, and they would just be that encourager. God is doing something. Don't stop. Don't give up. Yes, it hurts. God is doing something. Would that not rock your world? Would that not say, whoo, God is doing something? Because us left to ourselves, we're like Schlepprock, right? Woe is me, woe is me, woe is me. But if we have brothers and sisters in our lives, like Brother Hector was talking about, doing life together, oh, they're going to encourage us. Peter encourages us. He says this. He says, beloved, do not think it what? Strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though something strange has happened to you. Have you ever been just doing life, and then all of a sudden, there's a trial? You're like, wait a minute, I'm going to church. You know, I haven't cut anybody off lately. You know, I'm doing the best to love people. I'm in my word. I'm praying. I'm serving. In the world did this trial come from? What did I do wrong? God, are you punishing me for something? We're like, this is strange. Peter says, don't think it's strange concerning this fiery trial, which is to try you. The disciples didn't say, why me? Why us? We're not doing anything wrong. God's at work with his plan and his purpose. Here, Peter's quoting from Psalm chapter 2 when he says, who by the mouth of your servant David have said, why do the nations rage and the people plot vain things? The kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. Why is this important? This is letting them know many, many years ago, this is what's going to happen. If we know something is going to happen, that means we can prepare for it. Amen? Maybe some of you, before you go to work or something, you look at the traffic report or you look at the weather. How should I dress today? That's what my wife and I do. Before we drive up the hill, we're like, how cold is it going to be up there today? Thus, rocking some thermals today. That's right. Got on my phone. What is the temperature in Beaumont, California? Siri told me. I'm like, oh. It's cold again. So I was able to prepare for what I knew to expect. Having the Bible lets us know that you're going to have trials and tribulations. That's what Jesus said, right? But he says he's what? Overcome. Overcome the world. He says, hey, you're going to have some difficult times, but guess what? I have overcome the world. So the disciples here are quoting from Psalm 2, letting them know, hey, what's happening to us, that's going to happen. Okay. This is all according to God's plan. This is not some type of surprise thing going on. It says in verse 27, For truly against your holy servant, whom you anointed, listen to this, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together, what does verse 28 say? To do whatever your hand and your purpose determined before to do. What? Herod, Pontius Pilate, the Gentiles, and the people of Israel, they were gathered together to do whatever his hand had purposed. Jesus was before Pontius Pilate. They were having a little conversation, and this is how it went down. Then Pilate said to him, to Jesus, "Are you not speaking to me? Do you not know that I have power to crucify you and power to release you?" Listen to what Jesus says. It says, "You could have no power at all against me unless what?" From, whoa, fancy that. Pilate's saying, "Hey, I'm the man. I have the power to crucify you or to release you." And then you know what Jesus says? He says, "You know what? You don't have any power over me, actually. The power that you have was given to you from my Father." You see, that puts everything in perspective. That's why we never read in the Bible, "And Jesus freaked out." And Jesus wondered what was going on. Because all of the power had been given from above. That's why Jesus could simply trust in his Father's plan and purpose for his life. He's letting Pilate know, "Pilate, you don't have any power over me." Because Jesus trusted in his Father's purpose. And it's so wonderful as you and I continue our walk with God that we would trust in God's purpose. That maybe some people exercise power over you and you're going, who are you to do this? Just maybe God has placed that person in your life for a reason and for a purpose, to bring about his will. Now, sometimes when people exercise their power over us being adults, we don't like it very much, do we? When people tell you no, how do you feel? You're like, "Psh, I'm a grown man. Who are you to tell me no?" A little pride kind of wells up. Just maybe God has placed that person in your life for a reason and a purpose. Well, family, it is here where we must follow in the steps of those who have gone before us, who have trusted in Jesus' purpose for them through this thing called life. James goes on and says, "Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him." Now, this word temptation doesn't just mean in a lustful way. It also means adversity, affliction, or trouble sent by God and serving to test or prove one's character and faith. So let's read this verse again. "Blessed is the man or woman who endures adversity, who endures affliction, who endures trouble." Blessed if you endure these things, as you endure adversity. Blessed, why? Because God is doing a great work. So if adversity or trouble is in your life right now, God says you're blessed. If you endure, that means we can't just hit eject when difficult times come, when adversity comes, because God is doing something. And the reward is we're going to receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Thank you, Jesus, for sometimes sending that thing called adversity. No amens for that one, huh? You're like, we're not there yet. We're all walking towards that. So whatever you're involved in right now, if there's some adversity, if there's some affliction, you keep holding on, amen? You keep holding on. God's not going to leave you. Blessed is the man that endures adversity, affliction, and faith. Thank you, Jesus. Well, verse 29, it says, Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. I love this. A, They're praying for power, for boldness. Lord, help us to be all that you've created us to be. God, give us boldness to preach your word. And as Brother Hector says, give us boldness to open up our home. Give us boldness to read 10 scriptures and ask 5 questions. God, give us boldness to be used by you. God, give us boldness for these trials. Give us boldness for this affliction that we're going through. Give us boldness, Father, that we're not afraid to share, that we're not afraid to step out. This word boldness means freedom in speaking, unreservedness in speech, free and fearless confidence. I love this one. Cheerful courage. God, give me some cheerful courage. You guys remember the story when the disciples were in a boat and Jesus comes walking to them on the water, and Peter says, "Lord, if it's you, command me to come out on the water. If it's you, just give me one of these. God, give me some boldness. God, give me some faith. Give me some strength." Peter could have said, "I can't walk on water, but what am I doing in the boat if you're out there, Jesus? Jesus, give me something that I don't have right now." Family, what's the worst that could have happened? He could have drowned, right? But guess who saved him? So if the worst that could happen was Jesus was going to save Peter, how is it a bad thing? If the worst thing that could have happened with Peter stepping out of the boat is Jesus saving him, that's not a bad, is it a bad thing, Jesus saving you? No, not at all. So Peter could have said, "Why am I here in the boat?" Listen to this. The other 11 guys were watching Peter walk on the water. Why didn't they ask to come out? They're fearful. Well, what's the worst that could have happened? Jesus had to save 11 people, 12 people. But they let their fear keep them in the boat. When the worst thing that happened to Peter was, Jesus says, "So, why did you doubt?" That was it. They remained in the boat because they were fearful. Can you imagine walking on some water? I can't, but I would love to try it. They had the opportunity, and because they were so fearful, they stayed in the boat. When the worst thing that could happen is Jesus is going to save them. What's the worst thing that could happen in your life if you step out in faith? Same thing. Jesus will save you. That's it. The worst thing that could happen is Jesus will have to save you. So why not step out of your boat? Why not say, "God, I need some boldness. God, I'm a little afraid. I'm a little nervous. I'm a little scared. But I'm going to come out anyway, because the worst thing that can happen is you're going to have to save me." Yeah! If the worst thing that's going to happen in my life is Jesus is going to have to save me, sign me up. Because I think the worst thing that can happen in our lives is that we can remain in our boats. We can remain in our boats and be safe. Peter is asking for some boldness. Give us something that we need. We're still afraid. We need you, God. That's what I love about the scriptures. It's just plain. It tells it just like it is. God, we are afraid. Anybody ever scared? God, you know what? This area in my life scares me. I don't know how it's going to work. Just openly confess that to God. And then say, "God, give me your Holy Spirit. Fill me. Give me this boldness that we're reading about." Peter and the guys didn't say, "You know what? Well, we can just do it on our own strength, our own skill. We're awesome." No. God, give us your Holy Spirit. We need this boldness. It's okay to be weak. The Bible says that his strength is made perfect in weakness. I love this picture here. I admit that I'm weak, but I have a strong God. There's nothing wrong with being weak. Because we turn to God and we say, "God, I'm weak. I don't know how you're going to do this, but with your help, I can do great things." The Apostle Paul says, "I was with you in fear and trembling." The Apostle Paul is a stud of the scriptures. I mean, this guy is like super Christian guy. And he's talking about, "Hey guys, I was with you in fear and weakness." You're going, "Paul? The Apostle Paul wrote the majority of the New Testament?" He is with people in fear and weakness. Why? What was his source? His source was God. You know the difference between the Apostle Paul and us? You know what that is? Nothing. We serve the same God. We fill with the same Holy Spirit. The difference is, if there is any difference, the Apostle Paul knew his purpose. And he asked God for power to fulfill that purpose. Only difference. Only difference. Same God, same Holy Spirit. Well, Peter goes on to say, by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through your name, through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. So the prayer is for more power. We want more healings to happen that we might be able to tell people about Jesus. Hey, this is a guy that was at the gate called Beautiful. He's been here for years and years and years. Why is he jumping around? I'm glad you asked. There's a man named Jesus who was resurrected from the dead. Let me tell you a little bit about him. Verse 31, it says, and when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And what's the result? They spoke the word of God with boldness. God, give me more of your Holy Spirit, more of your Holy Spirit, more strength, more power, and more boldness. You see, persecution didn't cause the church to go like this. Hey, this is too much suffering. Hey, we're out. We're going to try something different. No, persecution said, let's come together. We need to get together. Oh, yeah, we need to lift each other up. Oh, we need to encourage each other. That's what's so phenomenal about life groups. We can come together and say, hey, what you going through? You know what? We're going to lift you up. Monday is your day. Praying for Lily on Monday. Monday is her day. Hey, Tuesday is Hector's day. Wednesday is somebody else's day. Knowing that when you get involved in a group, you're doing life together. Someone's lifting you up. Someone is encouraging you. Not sure about you, but sometimes I get what's called stinking thinking. Anybody ever been there? You're like, that's going to be horrible. It hasn't even happened yet, and you're already way down the road. God is going, what are you doing? Bring that back. Bring that back. So when we have people in our lives, they can say, hey, let me reel you in a little bit. It's going to be okay. Everything is going to work out. Hey, let's read the scriptures together. Things are going to be just fine. Well, verse 32, it says, now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. We have number two, believing in God's plan. Persecution's going on. Things are kind of crazy right now. But nobody said, hey, this is mine. This is mine. That's none of yours. No, they had all things in common. Listen to what the Bible says. I'll give you a couple of scriptures. Acts 2, verse 1 and 44. It says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with what? One accord in one place. Now, all who believed were together, and they had all things in common. The early church was thinking awesome. Those guys were great. Listen to what David Guzik says. He says, God first, people second, and material things a distant third. God first, people second, and material things a distant third. How are you ladies doing this morning? Doing all right? Yeah. How many of you have like some china that you only break out every special occasion? Anybody? You have it like locked in the cabinet, right? All on display. People can just walk past it, right? Don't open it up. Don't touch it because it's special. You're probably going to leave that to your kids. You know what they're going to do with that china? They're going to cook oatmeal in it. My wife is not in here, so don't let her know. This whole china thing, it's all precious and nice, and we break it out once in a while. She went to a woman's retreat, and I'm like, I'm not washing anything. Let me see what I can find. I'm like, ooh, that's the untouchable china. Put that thing on my lap and had a great bowl of oatmeal, and she never, ever knew. It was a keepsake. It's all special. We're going to leave that to our kids. They are going to thrash it. Anybody have kids? The things you're holding on to that are so precious to you, you're going to leave that to them. They are going to thrash it. You would roll over several times when you see what they're going to do to your precious things. The things that are locked up, the things that no one can touch, the things that have a combination code, they are going to thrash it. So my call to you is don't hold on to stuff like this. Let people use your china. What's the worst that can happen? Now, you might be mortified to see what they put in it. But whatever you have, bless people with. We sing a song, you give and you take away. We love to sing when you give. When God starts taking stuff away, not so much of a smile on our face, right? God help us that our possessions don't possess us. That won't make us smile too much. We're always, you get a new car, you have to worry about somebody dinging your door. So some of you park a mile away. Hopefully there's no one in here that takes up two parking spaces. Don't want anybody to ding my door, so I'll take two parking spaces. God help us. We have to finish quickly. Verse 33, and with great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them. They continued to preach about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It was all about the resurrection. They didn't stray from, hey, this Jesus whom you crucified, God has raised from the dead. And the result is, the Bible says, great grace. I'm not sure what great grace is, but grace is already good. But great grace was upon them all. How wonderful. It says in verse 34 and 35, nor was there anyone among them who lacked. For all who were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of the things that were sold. And they laid them at the apostles' feet, and they distributed to each one, to each as anyone had need. Again, this early church was just so phenomenal. Now, is God asking us to go sell our houses and lands? Well, maybe God is calling some of you to do that, but it's not a requisite. We don't have to do these things, but obviously God moved on the hearts of these people so much so that they said, hey, it's about Jesus and my new brothers and sisters. I don't want to see them going without. So how can I bless them with what I have? And they said, hey, let's go sell a couple of things. Let me give you two things, and then we will go home. We had a lot to say, but I let you guys off easy today. Oh, so Jesus has a conversation with a rich young ruler, it's called. So he runs up to Jesus, and he says, hey, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus says, hey, why do you call me good? So Jesus says, you know the commandments, you know, keep the commandments. So they have this little conversation. The guy ends up saying, hey, well, I've done all of these things since I was a little youth. He was lying, obviously. So Jesus said this, looking at him, I love this. Looking at him, he loved him because he knew what was coming. He says, one thing you lack, go your way, sell whatever you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. He says, and come take up your cross and follow me. But he was sad at this word, and he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. I would say his possessions were possessing him. Jesus said, hey, just give it all away to the poor. Come follow me. The walk of a lifetime. And he said no, because he had these possessions. How sad. You said no to following God in the flesh because you had all of these possessions. Now, is there anything wrong with having possessions? Absolutely not. There's something wrong if your possessions have you. What was great about the early church is they followed this scripture. Here, listen to this. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But what? Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. That's the question. Where is your heart? Is your heart in these treasures, these things you have? Or if Jesus says, hey, I want this and I want this, how are you going to feel? You see, if our treasures are in heaven, things are going to work out really, really well. So make sure your possessions aren't possessing you. Amen?
Amen.
Two things to take home. Number one, plug into a life group. You are going to grow exponentially. You're going to learn much, much stuff about the Bible. Plus, you're going to get a chance to do life together with one another. It's going to be phenomenal. Just think, you're going to know the person sitting next to you. Well, most of you should know the people sitting next to you. Maybe you're going to learn the people that are in your row. How are the row monitors doing today? If there's somebody new in your role, you know what your job is to do. Introduce yourself. Lady to a lady, exchange some phone numbers. Guy to a guy, exchange some phone numbers. So plug into a life group so you're not doing life all by yourself. We would love to have everyone here involved in a life group. And then lastly, life is bigger than you. Trust God's plan and purpose for you. Trust God's plan and purpose for you. Life is so huge and big, and oftentimes it's out of our control. But that means we have to trust God. It's a little scary sometimes, huh? God means we have to wait. Sometimes it's painful. But as we trust God for his plan and his purpose for our lives, I don't think God makes any mistakes. I don't think God said, oh, I'd like to do that one different. I think we can trust God. Trust God, even in your pain right now. Trust him that he has a plan and a purpose, that he's going to work out everything according to his will. Amen?
Amen.
Father, we desperately need you. Father, we don't always understand your plan, but we know you have one. We've read it. Lord, sometimes your plan and our plan are against each other. Sometimes your ways aren't our ways and your thoughts aren't our thoughts. But Lord, help us to be okay with trusting in you. Help us to have some resolve and some boldness to say, my God knows everything and his plan is perfect. Father, may we know our purpose. For the time that we have on this planet, may we know what our purpose is, to preach the gospel, to love one another, to give of self, to leave our mark on this world for Jesus. Father, give us your Holy Spirit that we might be bold enough to affect lives for the cause of Christ. Because the worst that could happen to us is the greatest that could happen to us, is that we're going to go see you one day. Your word says, oh, death, where is your sting? By us dying is just delivering us to the lover of our soul. So help us this moment, this day, this hour, to be filled with your purpose, Jesus. That we're not just walking around this place with blinking batteries. That we're not just walking around this place low on energy and low on fuel. Help us to plug into your Holy Spirit. So Jesus, we pray that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit, that we might be bold enough just to speak a word. God loves you. Jesus has a plan for your life. Jesus, we do love you. And forgive us, Lord, sometimes for allowing the pain to speak those lies to us. You know all things. Jesus, you went through an enormous amount of pain for us. And you didn't give up. You saw it through to the end. Help us to fight the good fight. Fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit. And Jesus, we love you. We can't wait to see you. But until we do, help us to journey on. Help us to trust in your plan and in your purpose. So may we leave this place. May people say, you were just with Jesus, huh? You were just at the feet of Christ. be magnified in these broken vessels. Do great things, Lord. We are weak, but you are so strong. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I want to encourage you, just in the quietness of your heart, just say, God, I believe your Son died on the cross for me and rose again the third day. Jesus, I'm calling out to you. Whoever calls upon the Lord shall be saved. Just call out, Jesus, I need you. Come and make yourself at home in my life. I repent of my sins, and my life belongs to you. If you said that prayer, the Bible says that you're born of the Spirit. You're born again, and I would love to meet you and to pray with you and give you a Bible if you don't have one. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for today, Jesus, and the joy that you give. We ask all of these things in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Hey, please.